It is really a pleasure of mine to introduce to you Professor Joseph LoBianco. Professor Joseph LoBianco is Professor of Language and Literacy Education at the Melbourne Graduate School of Education. And he serves as immediate past president of the Australian Academy of the Humanities. He is indeed the first educator elected to that role. He is the author of more than 125 refereed articles and 25 books and reports. He has been an active member of the Italian-Australian community organizations for many years, a former president of the Dante Alighieri Society of the Australian Capital Territory, and he has conducted research on Italian in Australian education. He supervises PhD projects and teaches courses in language planning and supports international research projects in several countries on language and culture studies, language planning and multiculturalism, as well as intercultural education. Professor LoBianco wrote Australia's National Policy on Languages back in 1987, the first multilingual national language policy in an English-speaking country, and he was chief executive of the National Languages and Literacy Institute of Australia until 2002. The National Policy on Languages was adopted by the Australian government as a comprehensive national plan to cover all of Australia's language needs and interests. This included English and English literacy, English as a second and foreign language, and languages other than English, which includes Indigenous language rights, immigrant, and foreign languages, as well as language services, which include research, translating and interpreting, and public media. Since 2011, he has served as senior research advisor, and I'm not sure if you pronounce this lucid or lucide. Lucide. I went for the English or the Italian, which is a European Commission project on, and now we know what it means, languages in urban communities, integration and diversity for Europe, conducting large-scale four-year research on multilingualism at the municipal level in 12 European cities. In 2012, he was appointed research director of the UNICEF Language and Peacebuilding Initiative in Malaysia, Myanmar, Thailand. In January 2012, he began an academic advisory role with the National Research Center for Foreign Language Education at the Beijing Foreign Studies University, providing advice to the State Language Commission and supporting academic research initiatives. Professor LoBianco has advised on language, culture, and literacy education, and on the integration of Indigenous and immigrant children into mainstream schools, as I said, as well as reconciliation and peace through education in many countries, including Council of Europe, Sri Lanka, Ireland, Wales, and the UK, Italy, Slovenia, Canada, Vietnam, Singapore, South Africa, and the list goes on. The title of his talk today is The Diasporas on the Move. Prego.
Thank you very much for that kind invitation. I should warn you before I begin that this is peak time for jet lag. So if I disappear at some point, it won't be rudeness and it won't be intentional. I hope you can see this, or that makes it better. Because I'm going to rely a lot on this PowerPoint, but before I begin talking about that, I want to just thank the organizers, and Anthony in particular, for inviting me. I'm very delighted to be here. I love this city, and it's a splendid opportunity to renew my acquaintance with it. I did my PhD in Washington, D.C., and came to New York a few times during that period of time. And the focus of my research for my PhD was language politics in the United States and the whole and the debates in the Congress during the 104th Congress, the first Republican Congress in 40 years. And so I did this discourse analysis of how nation and belonging was constructed in American political discourse at the time. What I'm going to talk today about is basically two big themes, and I'm not really sure I've reconciled them very well. So with your help, I'll do that. One of them is a kind of philosophical discursus about the nature of diaspora. And in particular, I'm going to rely on the work of Thomas Nail, an American political philosopher, who's actually just recently written a completely remarkable book recovering interest in Lucretius and his, I've just finished reading this book, and it's really quite magnificent if you like Lucretius. And he uses this as a, you know, a deep way of instantiating his belief that all is motion, fundamentally from the Epicurean tradition in Greek philosophy. But he's written wonderfully about migration as well, and extends this, I think, physics focus to migration, which is a very odd journey to make. Not many people do this. So, but he's influenced some of my thinking on this, although I don't go all the way with him. And then I'm going to talk about this in relation to some sociological presuppositions about what a diasporic experience is, what a diaspora could be, in a time in which, you know, the term which arose to describe the spread of populations across places far from homelands, in at a time when boundedness was very clearly understood as what nations were, how nations were constituted, and how deeply language was informing those, especially European nations. I mean, Italy, preeminently a nation created around a language that hardly anyone spoke in 1861 anyway, how we could still use this notion at a time of really immense mobility. So recuperating a notion that arose to describe population transfers in a completely different environment to a contemporary one is a very challenging one, and I think very relevant to every paper I've heard at this conference so far. But then I'm going to move from that to a very practical question, because I'm also a language planner and I do a lot of practical work in countries all around the world on the question of subnational languages. These might be languages of indigenous groups of people or of national minorities, subnational minorities, or immigrants. Obviously, Italian in Australia, in the United States. I'm going to talk a lot about Italian in Australia. Not a great deal, as much as I'd like to, but as much as I can fit in. So they're the two components of the talk. I'm going to try to integrate them, because I think the deep philosophical and sociological questioning of what a diaspora is instantiated in what we understand as language maintenance and intergenerational transfer of language. And unfortunately, I think here the US and Australia are on very different planets, because we have radically different experiences of Italian migration. Our migration is later, and it's happens under different circumstances, and we didn't experience the Americanization practices of the early part of the 20th century, which were responsible for the loss of so much of Italian in this country. So that's basically my trajectory. Diaspora studies in general, like what diaspora studies mean or could mean, is a booming field of research and investigation, and it's a subset of mobility, understanding new forms of mobility, or understanding mobility as central to human social formation. And this boom in the focus on diasporic experience is actually not connected with the sociolinguistic experience, which I'm going to talk about later. So I'm going to try and make this connection. So I call this the mobility's turn within sociology. There's been a focus away from fixedness, from stability, from formation, towards normalizing movement, towards normalizing transgression across borders, these kinds of ideas. So, as it says here, the mobility's turn in, if this works, it'll help me to overcome the fact that you can't read this. Sorry, that was my assumption that you would be able to read it, but the screen is too small. So the mobility's turn in the social studies places globalism and transnationalism at the center of understanding those who move, but also those who stay. Even though the proportion of people who move in the world is relatively small compared to the proportion of people who stay, it's vastly greater than it was, and it's growing rapidly all the time. And new identities are attached to multiple places and also to none. We're increasingly defined not so much by where we are or where we came from, but by relationships in flux. I'll describe some of that a bit later. So movement is also a stratifying factor, and so societies around the world, because unlike at other periods of time, there is now no particular socioeconomic configuration to movement. Poor people move in vast numbers, rich people move in vast numbers, people stage their lives in different parts of the world on the basis of their economic ability to do this, or they are forced to do this by their economic inability to do it. So the relationship between economic means, which is the dominant narrative or the dominant force in Italian historical migration, is now something that's heavily scrambled. There is every kind of mobility. Obviously, we must extend this and go towards tourism and international students, the commodification of education and the existence of English as a global language. Both of these things have produced enormous population transfers, really, that stand up even at the World Economic Forum, where people can count the economic size of the global effort to learn English. These are countable now. They are so large. So all of these things have made mobility and movement a central feature. So whether by choice or by force, whether by the ability to return or the ability never to return, huge numbers of people are on the move. And I'm very interested in the effect that this has on national languages. I mean, a national language is obviously defined by its adjective, what the nation that it is attached to and it is said to describe. And what these movements can signify for this. So while diaspora studies and practices have been theorized widely, many issues have not been looked at very well within diaspora research, and one of the most important that hasn't been is language. And so I'm going to make the second part of the talk, the two-thirds of the talk, which will be the bulk of it, focus on questions of language regeneration. And I hope this will be interesting in an American context where, you know, the contrast between the 15.5 million Italian-Americans at the embassy in Washington, D.C. informed me last week when I checked last of people who have Italian ancestry in this country, and the number of people who actively speak the language is enormous. There's a huge contrast of language loss fundamentally. So a major problem with this theorization within sociology in particular of movement has been under theorization of the question of language and what language is and what it means. And there are many insights we can get to recover and recuperate this problem from what's increasingly called the Global South and perspectives from multilingualism, from societies that haven't nationed their languages through academies and canonical literatures and histories of punishing minority language speakers, which has been a way in which many nation states have functioned, including Italy. And there's another undermining to this new sociology of mobility, which comes from hybrid multilingualism, practices of translanguaging, practices of mixing, etc., which I think should be studied and respected more rather than repudiated and criticized. So my line of questioning is to move from the broad sociology and a little bit of philosophy to this. I think I change from here. Okay. I mentioned that Thomas Nail, so I told you I was very jet-lagged, devises, maybe I wanted to write this book and that's why I'm projecting myself into the title. Yes, that's got to be it. I nailed it, yes. He devises this radical new political theory of, and which I think is really should be used to inform not just his work, but the people he draws on as well, how we understand diaspora and diaspora experience. He looks at the old phenomenon of population mobility and gives it really deep new meaning. As I said, he's just recently published a book about Lucretius and subatomic particles, so he's really interested deeply in movement. So, and as he says, in the last decade alone has seen the highest number of migrations in recorded history, just in the last decade alone. And he argues, and I think this is really powerful, that the migrant is the political figure of our time. Figures of migration historically have been, according to him and other people, of course, the nomad, the barbarian, the vagabond, and the proletariat. But he says the figure of the 21st century, the central iconic organizing notion of 21st century life, is the migrant, the person who moves, the person who's displaced, the person who's against whom borders are applied. And out of this, he devises a keynote politics, a politics of movement, which places mobility at the center of new human identifications. And this is really important to the Italian, American, Italian, Australian, the Italian diasporas, all of them. And this transience or non-fixity or the flow that's involved in this to replace old assumptions of stable attachment to place. And this is actually attracting a lot of political and policy interest. It was mentioned before in the introduction that I was the president of the Australian Academy of the Humanities, and shortly after I left, the Academy with the other learned academies initiated a project that has won a lot of public attention from our federal government, which is called Australia's Diaspora Advantage. And this was a really interesting process of looking in this specific case to Indian and Chinese Australians as representing no longer the vulnerable and rejected minority population, but a source of potential resource interest for the country. And this actually massively contradicts the way typically Australia has regarded even its own region of the world. You know, we are attached to our region, the Asia Pacific region, like the US is to the Americas. There's the Avenue of the Americas just over there, in very different ways. We don't have a dominating history in it. We don't have a hegemonical relationship with it. We have a history of not belonging. And this is part of a national strategy of reconfiguring minorities as an asset. Now, I know informally this has happened a lot historically, but this is a quite self-conscious and large effort to invest in the language and cultural continuities of minority populations for the national interest. So quite explicit, and many people would disagree with the ethics of it, but nevertheless, it's a debate about this. And in the course of doing this really quite interesting study and a very outstanding report, in my opinion, the four learned academies came up with a very simple construction of what an advantage of a diaspora is and what a definition of it is. So it's in these five ways: a claim to a country of family origin. This is just a claim, that's all that is needed. Individuals who identify with this claim, individuals who develop emotional attachment to this claim and what it represents to them, who are connected despite being dispersed, and who can activate links to homeland and various host lands. Here we see the new idea of multiple diasporas implicated in this, and who are recognized by others for this claim, its attachments, emotions, and links. What's really interesting here is the amount of attention that's given to non-material things like emotions, attachments, identities, in basically an economic statement and a statement of future penetration of economic markets. So you can see there's a subtle, and I can assure you that it's fully replicated through the report, a subtle understanding of new economies as well, in which a lot of what occurs in new economic relationships are built on relationships as much as they are built on other things. So this is a new installment, I think, in thinking about what diasporic connections could mean, not just about internal connections that communities have with either homelands or other hostlands and their emotional and familial relationships with these, but what host societies do for this, which often argued against and tried to eradicate these connections because of the idea of disloyalty that they sometimes have suggested in history, and Italian Americans know this very well. So this is a what I call a reorganizing of the past vulnerability of minorities into an asset of language ability, contacts, local knowledge, and intimacy. And language is really central to this. Now, if we look at this, I'm going to develop this argument through a discussion of my take on what I think we should pluralize the expression, Italy's diasporas are. I think we can distinguish at least two historic temporal diasporas, two diasporas that we can identify in time. I think they fragment into multiple kinds of diasporas from that. So we'll call them two historic temporal diasporas. The first one coinciding, as we all know, with national unification in 1861 and concludes in the 1920s with the close of out-migration by the fascist regime in power in Rome and exclusionary policies in this country. And this really didn't impact on Australia very largely, although we did have substantial Italian populations prior to that. The second one clearly did. This was at the conclusion of the Second World War and lasted till the 1970s in general, for the reasons that we know, the greater economic success of Italy and the integration of labour markets in Europe meant that there was less need and desire for people to travel far away. And this third one, which I think has, I don't know if it can be really called a new wave, but anyway, since the economic crisis of 2008-2009, which, according to the Public Register of Italian Residents Abroad, which I think is AIRENO, rose from 3,106,251 in 2006 to 4,666,647 in 2015. So a growth of 49% in only 10 years. So I think we could call these century diasporas, a 19th century one, which America, Argentina, and Brazil are the main beneficiaries of, a 20th century one in which Australia becomes actively a participant, and a 21st century one, which is now an outflow of educated, precarious young. This third outflow is radically unlike its predecessors from several points of view. The first two led to massive language loss for several reasons, including the non-consolidation of standard Italian in the lives of most people who came to the United States, and the non-substantially consolidated standard Italian for the second group, my parents' generation who moved to Australia. But here we're dealing with standard Italian speakers who are highly literate and often very educated, so are really, in socio-educational terms, a radically different categorization. So the language loss challenge here is an interesting and different one. And the assimilation pressures that were the experience of the first two diasporas may not be as strong for these ones, because we know that ideologies of multiculturalism, however sincerely or insincerely they are believed by governments, are at least believed by governments, and they were not in the past. So I think these are quite significant differences. The vast numbers with overlapping attachments to Italy also mean horizontal links between various host lands only indirectly connected to the homeland. And what I mean by this are the way in which, for example, Argentinian Australians of Italian origin, because most refugee populations often contain a disproportionate number of vulnerable minorities within them because people self-select on the basis of their sense of vulnerability. And what we find with this is that there's no direct reference to the homeland, but to what unites people in different host lands. This is a new way to think about diasporas that doesn't make Italy. Italy is the informing center of this experience, but it's not dependent. The relationships are not dependent on existence or even any travel ever to Italy or any particular Italy centricity at all. And I think this is consistent with the new waves of thinking about diasporas that I was mentioning at the very beginning from sociological and philosophical positions. Now, I don't want to read all the figures here because I'm happy to make the slides available to you, but they are basically the numbers that I've been talking about in the first two diaspora outflows and the third one as well. What's significant is Tullio De Mauro's calculation, and those of you who know him, he was former Minister for Education, a great linguist. He died just a couple of years ago. And by his calculation, only 10% of the population of Italy in 1870 could speak standard Italian. So here we have questions of identity and language, which really question the way in which official Italian authorities have operated their language policies abroad on the basis of assumed modes of identity, which really have not been very realistically grounded. So I'm going to talk now about another kind of Italian mobility, which has expands the scope of these three diasporas into internal diaspora mobilities. In quoting a book by Ruth Ben-Ghiat and Stephanie Malia-Hom in 2016, published by Routledge, called Italian Mobilities. And what they do in this book, in the chapters in it, is also consistent with this same story about multiple diasporic experiences and multiple sociologies of these. They link many flows and directions of Italian mobility in and out, colonial, decolonial, neoliberal mobility tied to EU rights, tourism, and Italy's more recent transformation, very troubled as we know, into a language of immigration. Marked often by tragic stories, as we know, of shipwreck and confinement, and the global prominence of Lampedusa, and the astonishing tale of survival of small villages in Calabria, Sicily, and Puglia, and other places, and incredible controversies in the last few weeks with the current government attacking some of the hosting of new immigrants in small towns who can't keep their schools going otherwise. So this deep struggle to serve a new kind of incipient multiculturalism in Italy, where so many African Italian children are educated even as they are denied any citizenship, which they must request at 18. I'm sure you all know Mario Balotelli, although he was born in Palermo and played for the... He had to apply, like all children born of non-Italian parents, when he turned 18 to be granted citizenship. In most cases, it is granted. But nevertheless, it's been motivating of a proposal for a jus soli basis of citizenship, which I spoke briefly to a committee in the Italian Parliament in 2012 on this, and unfortunately it has not moved forward, and it probably won't under the current regime. In this persuasive account by these two editors, and I think they're at New York University, the Italian nation state has been defined by such diverse flows in all directions in what they call practices of mobility, very consistent with Thomas Nail's notion. And they link this, of course, to the Grand Tour and a whole lot of other ways in which mobility can be constructed. So I think it's really important to see these as a continuum of forms of motion and mobility around bordered spaces that are then identified with particular kinds of cultural and linguistic formations. So modern Italy as a nexus for human mobility, the destination of millions of tourists per annum, a prominent actor in Europe's contemporary refugee crisis, and the scene of the world's largest voluntary emigration in recorded history. All of these constitute, I think, overlapping forms of diasporic experience connected to Italy. So Italy today is a kind of perplexity for discussion of mobility, because over two centuries of outwards and several more inwards kinds of mobility, repercussions for relationships with nationalism, globalization, consumer life, leisure and labor practices. And they talk about this in this book as these mobility studies concerned by complex discourse and dynamics created by accelerating and interrelated movements of people, objects, information, capital and ideas which transcend national barriers and lead to networks and imaginaries that do not always map onto nation states. In fact, they do the opposite of that. So I don't know how clearly you can see this, but these are several images of both Australian and US depictions of classical diaspora experience, including the vulnerable minority when in times of conflict, the surfacing of national boundaries and the association of the languages that people speak with enemy status and the maintenance of these enemy statuses on the basis of the public use of these languages. So don't speak the enemy's language. We had precisely this experience in Australia too. And the here quotes from the New York Times, very hostile, aggressive, almost vicious rhetoric directed at Italian populations. Now, most of you, I assume, being Americans, would not have had the education of a British culture that we get used to get in Australian schools. We're often shown maps with lots of parts of the map marked in pink, and those parts of the map were, the pink parts were the British parts, and the implicit message of this was that one of our civic duties was to keep the pink bits pink. Well, this is a forever. This is a kind of a similar version, but for Italian diasporic presence. And as you can see, it almost rivals the British Empire in terms of scale and scope, and Australia bravely holding the balance in the far distance there. I want to move now to the second part of this. I just want to reiterate what I've been trying to say so far, which is that I think it's really important to inform our discussions with a more substantive notion of what diaspora means, and not to ground it in old ideas of a relationship between emigrated peoples and homelands, but to see it as horizontally dispersed across different host lands and characterized by mobility of multiple kinds within and across cultures and borders. And that I think that this characterizes a new kind of politics, which Thomas Nail calls keynote politics, the politics of movement, the politics of the negotiation of differences across boundaries. So dual citizenships is one of the examples of this. Foreign voting is one of the examples of this. People engaging in foreign aid and travel, all of these things that minimize the hold of national state citizenship on the money, the lives, the identity, the emotional attachments of individuals who increasingly see themselves as hybridizing people and able to build their own personal identities. I'm going to move now from this to concepts of language policy and planning and then link this to the diaspora and the Italian experience, and a depiction of how we can recover language lost under previous experience of hostility to multiple languages. And I'm going to cite the work of a friend and colleague of mine, Bernard Spolsky, who's now retired but used to be at Bar-Ilan University in Israel, who's originally from New Zealand. And he talks about language policy and planning as having three components. A very important installment in thinking about language policy and planning, because what he wants to do with this is to say that it isn't just about what governments do or what the Italian Institute of Culture does, what the New York Commissioner of Schools does, if that's the right title for the individual, what this university would do, but about these components, that what happens with language policy and planning, and we're thinking now about the recovery of lost language, which will be the theme for the second part, is a function of three acts: the language practices, which are the habits and usage of language. And the habits and usage of language is the sovereign space of speakers. Obviously, it's influenced by social attitudes. If you have hostility to the public use of Italian in the streets of New York, it's clear that people aren't completely able to control what they do. But in a situation in which that no longer exists, the habits and practices of people's language use is entirely within their control. It requires nothing from the Ministero della Pubblica Istruzione in Rome to do anything for you. It's entirely within the management and control of individuals and families. Language values, beliefs and ideologies about language. And we know, of course, that most language values consist of hierarchical organization of forms of language. People value standard literary forms of language above demotic vernacular forms of language. languages that are written are regarded more highly than languages that are not, although there's a radical reconstruction of the hierarchy through modern technologies, which are making speech for the first time in 1,000 years practically equal in its power to writing. But language values are a really important part, and again, this is within the control of communities and individuals and families. And then what he calls language management, that I call language policy, which he calls deliberate interventions in policy, regulations, and law. And I put that third because I think it's the least important of the three in shaping the language outcomes of populations. Now, this could be, of course, immigrant populations or indigenous populations or foreign language learning, whatever particular language practice we're talking about. So this is important to keep in mind, that when we're talking about language and language policies, I'm going to do now, that we're keeping in mind that the interventions that might be imagined are not just ones that governments need to take, the teachers need to take, and unfortunately, and I've tried many times to get them to adopt a wider view, the Italian Ministry of Education is grounded in a very old way of looking at how it supports language maintenance abroad, which is just teaching and just policy and just certain kinds of teaching. And I think that they misunderstand a lot of what the challenge for the maintenance of minority languages like Italian abroad is. I'll just give you a small example. A few years ago, I did a project for the Government of Ireland with some colleagues, one of whom I'm going to quote him, Francois Grand from Geneva University. And this was on Irish, the Irish language, or Gaelic, which, as you must know, is the official language of Ireland. It's the first official language. It's above English. And in the After 1922, with the formation of the independence of Ireland, this was a large project of the new Irish state, was to recover this language that had been oppressed so heavily, so actively under English rule. And, you know, a lot of studies have been done on attitudes to Irish, and no one wants Irish to die. Everyone believes it's a precious resource, a distinguishing feature of the country. And in all the surveys, every single student studies the language. Many people learn it. Nearly, I think, 80% of people under the last census claim that they actually know the language. But when you go and ask people who uses it, only 56,000 people use it daily. So despite these massive efforts of constitutional affirmation, of compulsory teaching in every single school, and some of the Gaelic schools, the Irish schools, the Gaeschkola, are the best schools in the country. It's not like they're bad schools. They are some of the best schools in the country that we visited, with very high academic scores. Despite all this, there is still a non-use of the language. It is still an endangered, dying language. So when I say that, I want you to think about these first two principles that Bernard Spolsky enunciates as the basis for redressing a crisis like this. It's not laws that will save languages, and it's certainly not even education systems. There are, in fact, four ways to reverse or slow language loss, and I'm referring now, and I want us to think about immigrant languages, but this applies to Navajo in this country and Pitjantjatjara in Australia, to immigrant and indigenous languages. From the point of view of an indigenous language, the loss, of course, is catastrophic because they're usually lost in all places where they're spoken, whereas for Greek in New York or Italian in New York, I mean, the language itself would not cease to exist in absolute terms. It would just cease to exist locally. So it's important to keep these in mind. I'm only going to talk about the fourth one substantially later, but I want to introduce the other four. And the first one is the personality principle for language rights, which is applied to Quebecois francophones in Canada. So a Quebecois who leaves Quebec and goes to some other part of Canada brings his or her language rights with them. So if they're in somewhere where French isn't spoken and they break a rule, or they want to go and buy a stamp in a post office, not that you do that kind of thing anymore, they could demand, and they do demand, but they have the right to demand of public officials that they address them in French. They bring their rights with them. And that's not available in the United States. It's certainly not available to us in Australia, and neither our country nor your country has a government that would be bold enough to imagine to do this. So this strategy for protecting language rights and building language revival is not available to Italian anywhere in the world, actually. Well, actually it is in Switzerland, as I'm going to talk about now. The second principle is the territory-based or the territorialization principle of language rights. And here you have in Ticino, for example, or two parts of Graubünden, or in Alto Adige, Südtirol for the Germans and the Ladin speakers. And this is where the language rights persist only within a territorially, a defined territory. So if that individual who drives too fast somewhere outside of Ticino, say in Zurich, the policeman who arrests this person and finds him is not obligated to speak to that person in Italian and explain what they've done wrong. They would speak to them in whatever the cantonal official language is. So the language rights reside only in a demarcated territory and don't go beyond that. Whereas in Quebec, but not all Francophones in Canada have this right, but Quebecois do, the rights travel with the individual. It's more complicated in Belgium, but we'll leave that aside. A third principle, and that's not available to us either. It's not imaginable that New Jersey might be declared an exclusively Italian-speaking space. I've tried to do that in my suburb with a few houses around us, and we don't think that the police would let us to get away with it. But so territory principle and a personality principle are unavailable to us. There is another principle which emerges through the evolution of time and would have required very different language attitudes from what Italian dialect speakers had to produce. But we can see it in some parts of the world with Lebanese Arabic, with and High Arabic with in Paraguay, with Guarani and Spanish, and in Switzerland with, and I always mispronounce these things, but Schweizerdeutsch and Hochdeutsch, Low German and High German, Swiss German and High German. And this means the permanent or long-term coexistence of a high and a low variety. And the reason they coexist is because they don't interfere with each other. One variety is exclusively reserved for some functions in the lives of everybody, and all those same people then use the other variety for a whole category of different functions. So everyone or the relevant populations are fully bilingual, but they divide the functions so that they don't mix with each other. And Charles Ferguson, who devised this original theory, did his work in Baghdad on Baghdadi Arabic, High Arabic and National Arabic, and argued that this demarcation can last for centuries and produce very, very stable intergenerational multilingualism. But that too is not available to us, or at least it's not happening. It's potentially available to immigrant speakers. It could possibly happen with Spanish in the United States with continual replenishment from Spanish-speaking immigration, but maybe not. Only time will tell. And then COD, and I'm going to talk about that now in a few moments. So I think this is really significant for two reasons, because language loss is a marker of something else. It's not just a marker of depleted communicative power, because we need to keep in mind that the people who came here and went to Argentina and the early immigrants in Australia were often people whose own communicative power was highly limited by their educational marginality. So it's very important that we see that something else is going on. And Joshua Fishman, who was here at Yeshiva University when I visited him, and at Palo Alto, where he also worked at Stanford University, argued long ago, and in a book in which I had a chapter with his on Australian Indigenous languages with a colleague, argued that language loss, and this is a very important thing to grasp for the cultural reasons for arguing about language maintenance, language loss is a late order form of cultural loss, and language attrition involves progressive reduction of users and uses. The second part of that is less relevant than the first part about cultural loss. He says language doesn't lead cultural loss, it actually reflects it. And so when you notice your language is gone, already you've lost so much else. So the recovery effort is immensely hard. Another reason why recovery is very, very hard is because some part of intergenerational communication requires the creation of spaces which are reserved for the dominated, fading minority language. If it just mixes constantly with the powerful language, it will be overwhelmed. Yesterday I mentioned to some people how in New Zealand the Maori elders created these language nests for the raising of children. They're called the te kohanga reo, and in which exclusively babies were raised, or infants were raised by grandmothers who were the only people who could speak the language because the middle generation had lost the language. And this recovered a traditional child-rearing practice in Maori life. And they were able to actively, by their own initiative, with very little government assistance, reverse, not completely, but substantially, produce thousands of five-year-old speakers of this language when there hadn't been for a long time. And then fortunately, government policy came in with provision in schools to allow continuation of this learning. So what was required in that was the recovery of a traditional child-rearing practice, a cultural practice of traditional life in Maori society. So this is why it's very important that when we look at these language questions, we don't look at them in linguistic exclusive terms. They are always deeply enmeshed within cultural practices, as we all know. So English in the lives of Italian Australians, Italian Americans, represents a prior commitment to a rival identity of the ethno-cultural context outside the home. And this already suggests that language planning, quite different from what Ireland originally did, that is just the law and the education system, which is how the Italian government thinks about the promotion of Italian abroad. Let's have more classes, more teachers, more programs, while in fact all the social institutions where it's possible to speak Italian speak only English, and the message the students get is that you don't really need to use this language, you can just learn its grammar. So the two main diaspora communities that I mentioned before tried to preserve their languages and pass them on intergenerationally through strategies that were fatal, that were doomed not to work for multiple reasons. It's more complex even than what I've said, but just for the purposes of getting this done. In 2001, Joshua Fishman published this Can Language Threaten Languages Be Saved? And I just want to mention only one point of this bit to put it all in context. Language maintenance or intergenerational language recovery is positioned competitively mostly in societies that think about boundedness in languages, one language being separate and separable from the others, as having a competitive relationship with it. And that one of the things that needs to happen is some level of social and cultural separation from mainstream institutions to allow opportunities for uninterrupted use of the minority language. So late order loss, a reflection of underlying cultural loss, and reversing language loss is very difficult because it involves social forms of reorganization and not just what teachers do in classrooms. Now, I was going to make some comparisons with Italian teaching in the United States, but I found it so difficult to get accurate statistics. It's really, really hard. Maybe I'm just not able to get them, but I looked at the Modern Language Association, the Embassy of Italy, whose figures are different from other people's, some studies done by people, this survey by, where is it, the American Councils for International Education, and all of this, and it seems to me, and I hope I'm wrong, but I suspect I'm not, that Italian is not very widely taught in public education and in any kind of education, and it's losing ground quite heavily in higher education. And it's not even in the top 16, although it is in the top 5 when we go to the higher education level. This is completely different from Australia. One of the successes that our multicultural history has produced, and Italian, I call it the Greeks-Italians phase of multicultural politics, is the normalization of the teaching of Italian. By some measures, it's the most widely taught language in our entire education system. It's equal nose and nose with Japanese. Well over 1 million people, and this is a very big percentage in our terms, in Australia, have some knowledge of Italian. The census statistics are not great, but studies that we do, ethnographies of use of the language done by people at Sydney and Melbourne and Adelaide show this. And this community of Italophones consists of Italians residing in Australia, especially the post 2008-2009 new diaspora, Italo or Italian Australians, non-Italian Australian Italophones. And this is buttressed by a quite significant public prominence of Italian cultural messages within public life in Australia and cultural life, which is really very prominent, a radically different experience from what my parents had when they came to Australia. The Italian is really completely different. I mean, I'm sure many of you know this, of course. And we have two streams of this that supplement each other, a formal public education teaching of Italian where, unfortunately, I've just done a study for the Greek government on the equivalence of Greek, and they made a particular choice 7 years ago, which was very fatal for their fortunes in public education, were quite different from the choice that the Italian communities made. They made the choice of emphasizing ethnicity, and unfortunately the language has practically disappeared from public education now. So these two streams of the foreign language, the community language, and they are mutually reinforcing. And Italian in many primary schools in Australia is understood as an apprenticeship language, the language that you learn regardless of who you are, whether you have an Italian ethnic background or, you know, as a standard Italian speaker or, you know, speaker of another Italian language. We should stop calling them dialects, for goodness sake, but speaker of another Italian language. And the learning of standard Italian as an apprenticeship language to all other kinds of language learning because of its relative ease of acquisition. Now, when you say that to people who've struggled to learn Italian, they say, how can this be an easy language? But, you know, it seriously is by comparison with other languages. So this status that Italian seems to have achieved is not absolutely consolidated and secure, but it's quite remarkable, and it exists in no other country. And despite 5 or 6 missions that we've sent to the Ministry of Italian, the Ministry of Education in Rome, to explain to them that they need a more socio-culturally based form of support for us and not just teachers in schools. Look at Ireland, we say to us, and they say, why should we look at Ireland? Our language is not dying. But actually, in immigration settings, it is. So it's not been successful to persuade them. So we have had to make a lot of internal adjustments ourselves. And a lot of this is bumbling along and not science-led, but there is some retroactive science justification of it. So I'm going to show later some of the subliminal imagery that I think represents a kind of normalization of Italian, at least in Melbourne and Adelaide, I think more so than even in Sydney. So what is a healthy language? We have Italian in this kind of, you probably can't read that, but it says health, declining at home, holding on at school. Since the 1980s, research on Italian-Australian community confirms the following. We have substantial language shift. Anglicization, first and second generations, at whether it's prosodic level, semantic level, code switching, there's a great deal of the weakening of Italian through the encasing of Italian expression within English. And we have to do battle sometimes with people who want to let 1,000 flowers bloom because they think all of this is okay. But in fact, for weak languages and immigrant languages and indigenous languages are always relatively weak to dominant languages, this is not healthy. The second thing is we find second generation language erosion. Now, in the three generation, the 3G MOS model of language loss, the first generation is attached to the home language, the second and first generations, I think you use first and second slightly differently from us. By first I mean people born in Italy who come to Australia. Second generation are people like me born in Australia to Italian parents who speak Calabrese in my case at home. And then the third generation are our children So in the 3G model, by the third generation, we have just nostalgia and efforts to recover a lost language. In the first generation, we have excessive attachment to it. And in the middle generation, we have bilingual communication. And through different forms in different diaspora communities of attachment to the home language, we have four or one generation. This is just an average. You know, Dutch and German speakers tend to shift to English in Australia and Canada and other places in the first generation, like almost immediately. Vietnamese, Greeks, and Chinese Australians tend to take four, even five generations to reach the same point. In Italian, it's predictably three, and the erosion is deeply set in by halfway through the second generation's own independent adult life. And a large part of this is the complication of attitudes towards, in inverted commas, dialect, coming from teachers who come from Italy, or even teachers trained historically in Australia, who have very judgmental, negative views about dialect and the effect that this has on children's desire to identify with the language configuration, we'll call it, all of the varieties of Italian speech. 1991 to 1996, Italian speakers down by 10%, 418,804 to 375,752. Increased rate of shift from 11 to 14% among the first and 49% to 57% among the second generation. By 2006 census, we had 400 immigrant languages represented in Australia and some 250 indigenous ones. Italian declined by a further 16% and is now placed second after Cantonese as the most cited language of the home. But when we go to the school, so we have this erosion in the home domain, but when we go to the school, we have an extremely vibrant presence of the language. I hope you can see this, but the total enrolments in language study, and I'm going to talk only about the state of Victoria, I'm currently engaged by them to do a report for next year, which we're calling, for February next year, which we're calling the ecology of language provision, in which we're trying to get the after hours and Saturday programs actively integrated with public education to have, as much as we can manage to do this, seamless forms of integration so the children don't see forms of separation and then make judgments about of value on the basis of this. But as you can see, at the primary levels, going all the way to the far right, 19% of the total enrolments in government primary or elementary schools and secondary schools and the VSL, which is a special little provision that was created in 1936 to teach Italian and Japanese. The Victorian School of Languages, which teaches 57 languages, a specialised unit, of which I am the patron. 19% teach Italian, Chinese, Mandarin, 18%. So it's the most popular language in our public education system. Almost 20% of all pupils doing any language in our public education system in Victoria are doing Italian. It's absolutely unprecedented anywhere. If we look at the number of levels of programs, not students enrolled, we see that 321 schools in Indonesian, which is a big language in Australia because of the proximity of Indonesia, and down to Italian at 277. But then when we add the change in programs, we see decline in Indonesian and even in Japanese and growth in Italian. And this happens at a time when the Australian public education system, under the pressure from the federal government, as I mentioned with the diaspora studies before, the diaspora advantage, heavily promoting Asian languages for economic reasons and being very silent on other languages or even sometimes negative about them. And you can see these figures represented. Now, Italian is the dark blue, which is the top one. And as you can see, despite a dip in 2012, when people said, oh, now it will be the surge for the Asian languages, it in fact has come back again. And it has come back in the interviews that we've done, and we've done a kind of analysis called Q sorting, where we ask children to rank statements of a belief in relation to languages. Italian has this value as an apprenticeship language. It's not just justified as a language of Italy or of Italians or even of Italian Australians. It is a language of academic usefulness. It is a language that helps us to learn other languages. It's a language that helps us to learn other academic subjects. I think this has been our biggest success. I don't think it consolidates Italian permanently, but it actually gets us over the hump that was the crisis that some other communities that linked the study of their language exclusively to a sense of identity. I think it's important to do that, but not to do it exclusively. As you can see, the great languages of public instruction, French and German, the historical prestige languages of our public education system, like yours, are languishing at the bottom. I mean, I wish them well. I wish they would lift, because we've still got a lot of students who don't do languages. But so it's not that story I want to tell here. It's just the story of the fact that this is not a language of ethnicity that's being promoted here. This is a language whose sociology is already something else. And in secondary schools, unfortunately, we see quite a different picture. We see that because of the more vocational and higher education-oriented decision-making that students may do in the secondary level, Italian is less associated with this, and so it tends to suffer some attrition, but it still does reasonably well. I want to show you this figure, this chart, simply because of the blue line, and the blue line represents the state of Victoria, all languages, and this is the elementary school or the primary school. And at 2012, when there was this big move, when we basically, with the Ministry of Education, issued all of these statements about the critical importance of second language education to English literacy development. And on the basis of making credible, plausible links to academic progression, the study of languages boomed very greatly. So you can see from, you know, there was no new money, there were no new celebrities coming out and saying you've got to learn Italian because you'll ski better or anything like this. It just happened on the basis of making solidly plausible educational arguments. Look, I'll skip that. These two. Oh, I'm going backwards. Now I'm going backwards. Okay. So the enrollment trends are very healthy in schools. A healthy language. What is a healthy language intergenerationally? Immigrant languages in host societies can't expect the institutional levels of support that they have in their home environment, and they can't expect the levels of institutional support that the dominant language or the official language of the society they're in have. So clearly they have to have different kinds of strategies to become healthy. A language is healthy when it has two forms of transmission intergenerationally from the normalized home process of intergenerational transfer in the home, which we call a process of intimacy, where a language is associated with parental relationships, sibling relationships, it's used in informal activities, and when this intimacy, and this is what's missing in the Irish example I gave before, is linked to instruction, because in instruction in schools, we get formal academic language, we educated discourse, literacy, all of these things, and these supplement the vernacular that's acquired in the home. And it's the interrelationship between these two that predicts health, intergenerational health for a language. So to make an endangered language healthy, we shouldn't just do, and I don't mean to criticize them, but we shouldn't just do what the Italian national authorities constantly require us to do, which is to teach more language. We should teach more language, but we should do a lot of other things too, which we know that our language is endangered, not actually in public education, although the quality of those programs needs improving. We know it's endangered in public use. That's where its weakness is. So it isn't a question of more teachers in our case, it's a question of what I'm going to explain now, the COD. COD, this is capacity, that is increasing young people's linguistic ability, opportunities, creating reward and opportunities for use of the language, and these don't have to be material rewards, that can be symbolic ones, that can be forms of investment in identity. We've got many examples that we can talk about. And D, and this is the most problematical one, the most difficult one, fostering a desire for use of the language. Not for knowledge of it, because many people are motivated to know something. It's use of the language. Use is quite a different sociological fact from knowing something. Italian is not endangered yet in Australia, but it needs a lot of help to stay healthy. The domain of intimacy in the home is disrupted increasingly by English, outmarriage, and social pressure. The domain of instruction is dominated by English, even though Italian is relatively strong there. So this is cod. Do you have cod in the United States?
Baccala.
Or, yeah, okay. This is what cod is. This is there for a bit of a semantic tag for you to remember it by. It was devised by François Rhin at the University of Geneva and BIANCO, his colleague in Montreal, and I have extended it. And in a special issue of the Heritage Language Journal, we wrote on the vitality of heritage languages in the United States by applying this model. We couldn't get anyone to do a study for us in Italian, so Italian's not included in this, but German and Spanish and Chinese and a whole lot of other languages, including Navajo, are included. So, capacity, opportunity, desire, and the principles are: studying a language is not enough, having language laws is not enough, languages are not like other subjects, and it won't be schools and it won't be teachers that will save languages, critical though both schools and teachers are. Capacity is needed for language learning and maintenance because more proficient speakers tend to use the target language, those with less proficiency do not. And we develop capacity in intimacy in homes and families, and formally in education systems with teachers and lecturers in instruction. Intimacy in and instruction are often sufficient to produce knowledge and use of a mother tongue, but they're not sufficient to produce, to produce knowledge of the language. They're not sufficient to produce usage of it. It's certainly not in public situations, as we've learned from many parts of the world. How am I going for time? Keep going, okay. Opportunities to use a language are critical to success. Now, there are many, I'm sure this is the case in New York City and in other places, but our city of Melbourne is full of Italian clubs and societies. Every small town's got a club. And if you go to these, there's almost nowhere where these do not constitute an opportunity to use the language. Almost nowhere is Italian used. Not even so-called regional dialects are used, although I belong to a group that's promoting Sicilian based in the United States and the standardization and the reintroduction of Sicilian into primary schools in on the island of Sicily and in other places. And one of the interesting things about this is that the Paul Rausch, who's the initiator of this, has shown that there are almost no opportunities, public expected opportunities, for the use of the language. Really small language groups like Lithuanian speakers in Adelaide have for 45 years in the hills of Adelaide had language immersion camps. They can't get their language taught in any schools, but they maintain it through 2-week intensive camps in which it is expected that everyone will use the language. And of course, during the political conflict at the time, there was also this extra dimension of motivation through intensive contested relationships with the governance of Lithuania at the time. This perception already in some communities about how it might be productively maintained has been significantly lost in systems where people have extended what you would do to make Italian healthy in Italy, that is, concentrate on instruction, to what you must do in diaspora situations, which is a very different strategy altogether. You must revitalize intimacy as well as deal with instruction. So without domains in which the target language is the expected form of communication, then no amount of formal teaching or informal learning in intimacy will break the 3G pattern. It's a really important principle to keep in mind. However, even when we do foster opportunities for natural use in the language, learners will not do so unless there is a personal desire for them to do so. And I want to just tell you a small anecdote of when we were doing, with François and some other people, this project in Ireland for the government. We went to a place where there was still active use of Irish in some homes, but mostly English everywhere. And we interviewed some students about their use of the language. And there was this young girl, we'll call her Colleen for reasons of confidentiality, who was a very fluent speaker of the language. And we discussed with her why it was that she never used it, as she admitted to us in a preliminary discussion, the language with her friends. They always used English, even though all of them knew Irish well. And she was reflecting on it, and she couldn't think about it. And then she said, you know, I can't do her accent. It was too precious. You know, it's because with my friends, I'm a joker, and I don't know how to joke in Irish. Isn't that extraordinary that for something so almost banal that you would jeopardize intergenerational language maintenance? And yet, this is a fault of pedagogy, isn't it? It's a fault of pedagogy because the kind of instruction that she was given depended exclusively on forms of explicit knowledge of language and nothing about her sense of her own identity. She's a funny girl. She tells jokes. So when she tells jokes and laughs and talks about music and this, that, and that, and tells stories, she can only do these in a way that she feels she is emotionally and psychologically present in the narrative through English. So there was silence around the table when she said this, because we had actually just had a discussion precisely about this kind of neglect. So you can see these are kinds of micro cultural questions that it's very important to have strategic plans for language maintenance that deal with the people learning them, the children, their desire, their personalities, their experiences, their networks, and take seriously what they do. I was about to make another critical remark about, no, I won't do that. However, even when we do foster these opportunities, we need to take account of this personal desire. So this desire that Colleen had, very deep desire to be an Irish speaker, to be a bilingual, no one's talking about not being a bilingual in this case, of course, this capacity and the opportunity must be continued into desire somehow, must be nurtured alongside capacity. And we can do this actually in classrooms, but also in other environments. To convert these into actual language use, we need to cultivate and foster investment, not just in identification, but a learner's investment in being seen to be a successful user of the language. And one of the easiest ways to do this is to talk to them about how they imagine themselves psychologically to be. And if they imagine themselves to be a non-embarrassed speaker of a particular language, and you can create opportunities for them to do this, this disparity between the self-image and the projected image is minimized. Very simple things, but they are strategies that are really important to keep in mind. Personal identification of the community of speakers, but also opportunities in which these explorations of myself as a competent user of this language can be taken, with non-judgmental attitudes from teachers, and especially not from teachers from home country institutions, who often seriously damage the motivation of local people because they're so judgmental about the children's language and developing language and so on. We know this. So taken together, capacity, opportunities, and desire have been shown in research that Francoise done in many countries and that he and I and other people have done, and the heritage language study that we did in the US on the six languages we published in 2013, have been shown to convert a learned language, that is an instructed language, into the practical use of a language. Now, this requires us to understand the diaspora, what it is, what the lives, the hybrid mixed lives of children growing up here or in Melbourne are like. That's basically what I've been saying. I'm just going to finish now and talk about what I think are the three histories of Italian in our education system. And I think to try and wrap up these connections, I'll make some overarching observations at the end. The three histories of Italian-Australian education are two in the past and one in the making in this new global diaspora of tomorrow, where we must link the sociological analyses of what lived life in diasporic environments is like as an experience for young people with what we ask them to do in education. And the three experiences are the foreign, this is just my own terminology, the foreign, the demotic, and the projected identity. The foreign was actually the presence of Italian in the absence of Italians. This is how Italian existed as a minor bit player in the foreign language stakes. French, Italian, French, German, and Latin were the prestige languages of Britain, and so they were the prestige languages of Australia. And Italian made a kind of entry into this. But also in the 19th century, there was this wave of Italomania running through Britain, and Australia had all these ripples that we built Italianate architecture in Melbourne, and, you know, we even hosted Giuseppe Garibaldi on a little island in Bass Strait, and 10,000 people turned out to his to a commemoration of his death at the Sydney Town Hall. So there was, you know, this. There were no citizenship effects of this. This was a foreign, a strictly othered relationship. Of course, the period of the end of the Grand Tour. This was prestige, Italomania, and a ripple effect from Britain. This is transformed. And now, as you can see, the two languages that are most stuck in this modality, French and German, are suffering heavily within our public education system. But Italian, which has managed to maintain that historic prestige and add a demotic character to it with its community presence, the migration diaspora, hostland citizenship and homeland nostalgia, all of these kinds of things, now facilitated increasingly by technological communication, must will not last very long. We need to invest very heavily in this. And on the 11th of December, our ambassador has called a public meeting in Canberra at the embassy to talk about these ideas that we've been battering him for, to say for a long time the Italian Ministry of Education either doesn't understand or will not listen, that this is not like people in Belgium learning Italian and returning to Italy on a train. As you do, you need a radically different strategy. If you're going to help us far away, you're going to have to think about our lived world as non-Italian people connected to Italy. And this projected identity, which I can't talk about at great length here, but Italian is a learnable language. This is the idea of an apprenticeship. That Italian is a good choice for everyone because it's close to English. It's there's many ways we can justify this, because the Defence Language Institute tells us that it takes less time to learn Italian than it takes to learn a lot of other languages. There's lots of things we can use in our shtick, our rhetoric, to promote it with public officials. So it's apprenticeship thing, so we have to do that stuff. School success, we know that many learners can get really high grades with Italian. It's very motivating for students. It's very important for them as individuals. And this projected global identity imagined as a supplement of cultural global citizenship. This is a really important thing. If English has its global presence, as it does have today, it actually renders, a lot of people don't, people who promote other languages, I think, don't often recognize the power that comes to other languages from English fulfilling this auxiliary role. It means that all other second languages are practically equal, aren't they, as a choice anymore. If English is an auxiliary language when you want to do certain kinds of business, it means that your choice then for other languages can be very wide. So this third history that we are constructing now, the future diaspora identity, supplemented by technological possibilities that we've never had before, a national strategy for language maintenance, not teaching, but it must involve teaching, obviously. Because both Australia and Italy are diverging radically. I can't say this about the United States. Australia is linked more strongly to Asia, very deeply. It's very high priority of our public education system. And Italy is linked more strongly to Europe, although you wouldn't believe it if you read La Repubblica in the last couple of days. There's also a lot of convergence, new notions of diaspora that I'm talking about, economy, technology. So this strategy for Italian language maintenance, not just teaching in Australia, must conserve the old prestige of civilization, maintain the links of community, but mostly it must be premised on what we know motivates children to study and learn languages. All the things from banal examples of children's exploration of identity and their imagined future self as users of languages, two forms of substantive citizenship. That is, that the future idea of Australian citizens must be that they are all bilingual. We cannot any longer in a global world have other ideas. I'm going to finish with this. Now, this is my photograph of the Flinders Street tram stop. And one day I was there, and I've cut off the sign because I don't want to give free publicity to somebody. But basically, this was an advertisement that a public company was giving to people about, was offering to people about the waiting times. And they weren't using numbers. They weren't saying that there was a short wait or a long wait. They were saying that if you're on a tram that will be here in 15 minutes, you could have a latte. Cafe latte, really, but, you know, in Australia, it's always a latte. If you have a waiting time of 10 minutes, you might be able to manage a cappuccino, excessively frothy, in my view. If you have a shorter wait, you can permit yourself... that's a very Italianate way to say it, isn't it? You can allow yourself to have a macchiato and a quick ristretto if your tram is just coming. This kind of subliminality of Italian life in Australia is very deep, and I think it's important to recognize that this is also a diaspora effect. This is a success of our community that has struggled really very, very hard for a long period of time, is still stereotyped on many occasions and still struggles for a form of citizenship belonging that allows it its difference as well as its equality. But in many ways, it's actually succeeded very well. And part of this success is the normalization of its own practices of even drinking coffee. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you very much. A lot of food for thought. Here in the United States, there are some data that are in some direction go to what you said, but also are some contradictory in other sense. For example, when you say the prestige, if you look at the data, Italy is the second country where students studying at college go for a study abroad program. The first one is United Kingdom. So we are the first country where students go they don't speak English. Mm-hmm. Actually, they don't learn Italian when they go for a study abroad in Italy, because they go normally in those island study universities where we go to Florence during the summer, they only speak English, they don't learn Italian. But the prestige is to go to Italy to study, to do a period abroad. When you say the community presence of Italians here in the United States, we have a lot of Italians. Also, the majority of students of Italian, they study Italian at the high school, are of Italian descendants, third, fourth generation. Third, the usefulness, learnability, and apprenticeship, what you said. For example, here, they have a tradition of studying Latin to learn other languages. Also, I remember Prezzolini in the 30s wrote, Italian is the new classic, the modern classic language. So you can study Italian to learn about the Western culture and so on. So we have so all of these things here in the United States. But we are losing, as you said. Also, there is a data really interesting. At college, we have a ratio of 10 to 1. So, students, 10 students go to the introductory course, beginner, but only one goes to the higher level course. So that's a problem for us in that sense. But I remember a survey made by ACTFL in 2008. They asked the students at the high school, which is the language you would like to learn if it would be possible. Italian is the second place. So, something contradictory in that sense, but it's really a good idea to work on the COD. Even though I think that here you have also another problem, maybe different from Australia, the way how Americans, United States, see the foreign languages. You know, there's a joke about
I know that joke.
A trilingual is a person that knows three languages, bilingual, two languages. A monolingual is an American. So maybe that's also a point to take in consideration now, what you said.
I think the peak bodies of the Italian-American community so I'm going to say should jointly develop. Maybe you have. I don't like to teach people how to suck eggs, but it seems to me that there needs to be a national strategy for Italian that's a bottom-up one that builds on what we know and doesn't rely just... Because all the promotion that I've seen is about more teaching. And whilst more teaching is, as I've said, very important, it isn't enough. And there needs to be a strategy that talks about global citizenship as being rooted in bilingualism, as the 21st century literacy that's required, and that this is as true for Americans as it is for anybody else, and that it is and that builds on, extends, develops COD principles, because we know the weaknesses that come from ignoring the other dimensions of language maintenance.
I have to agree with you. You gotta have the desire to learn, and it does help with the help of the teacher that we will bring Lara. You know, Lara ways of
yes.
teaching, not just one way. Because I remember, because I'm going through this. I'm trying to learn the language, but I really have the desire. And I remember one teacher that he was keeping, tried to teach me that I had to be perfect.
Perfection's a big problem in life, I think. I agree. I mean, unfortunately, a lot of teachers and public education systems are, they're not, well, they're not, that's right, they're not really aware of sociolinguistics. This is, we're talking about the language and its social world and its social context, and principles of teaching, pedagogical principles are one thing. The destination we want to achieve, which might be fluent, correct, standard, literate forms of language, is one thing, but all the processes and the beginning points are completely different things, and those are what are neglected, because languages are not a school subject like geography. You don't walk into the street and see geography, but you see language. Languages are entities that are shoehorned into school curricula, and this means turning them into something they are not. They're turned into subjects, whereas, you know, we know languages are not subjects in ultimately.
In the States, one of the most one of the populations that's growing the fastest is Latin.
Latin
population.
Yeah.
Hispanic, Latin. This is actually, I hate to say it, but it's sort of like a competition because, okay, I live in New York, so obviously things are a little bit different. I see signs every day in Spanish. I don't have a problem with this because I see Spanish as the language that's the gateway to other languages, because to me, Spanish is much easier to learn than Italian. And I mean, I grew up speaking a dialect, and I continued studying. But I mean, it's kind of interesting because had we had this mantle of Italian, you know, showing up on signs, I think many more people would be speaking Italian. But I also think this is a kind of like a campaign that could possibly work by state, but I can't imagine us being able to pull this off nationally. Mm. So it's a little bit, you know, it's kind of a conundrum in a way. So,
yeah.
I don't know. And I know a lot of Italian teachers have had to also teach Spanish because that's the language that's in demand to be to be taught. So we're kind of in a little different spot.
Spanish is a special feature of American sociolinguistics, which we don't have. But, you know, Spanish is, there's more teaching of Wiradjuri, which is a traditional Aboriginal language in the state of New South Wales, than there is of Spanish. There's a lot of promotion of Spanish now. But, and I've been talking to Spanish friends and academics because I think it's really important to avoid competition, and I think it's important to anticipate the possibility of this and cut it off, because we had this very actively pushed by our federal government that there should be, the European languages should be thrown out and Asian languages should be put in. And, you know, when this happened at a time when 90% of final year school students didn't study any language, and our Prime Minister wanted us to have a competition. I remember having discussions with people in his office, and other people said, this is ridiculous. I mean, there's maybe if 88% of people were learning French, you could say that perhaps some of those could do another language, but that's not the reality. So I agree with your point that, but I think there is a solution to this, and one of them is to jointly, I hate this term, strategize with the with other language communities, because it's possible to build symbiotic relationships of learning. But the starting point has got to be educational practice, rather, you know, what children get from language. And as I said, the apprenticeship language idea in Australia for Italian is really strong. Indonesian has that as a little bit too, because Indonesian is the only major Asian language that doesn't have that uses the Roman script, and so children can learn to read and write in Indonesian relatively quickly, and it's a neighbor country with 130 million people. And so there's a lot of reasons why Indonesian is important to us from the national interest. So a lot of schools have got this kind of idea, let's have an Asian language and a European language, and often it'll be Italian and Indonesian. And the reasoning for doing this is about learnability. And I think that's worked very well for Italian.
Thank you so much for your presentation. It's incredibly inspiring for me. And I could just very much see my journey with COD, the concept, because it's really described my journey. So I'm probably a good example. I won't say perfect, but a pretty good example. Because I have Italian parents, so they're from Northern Italy. They didn't teach me Italian in the home, but I grew up staying at my grandparents, and they spoke Veneto and Friulano, grazie. And so I
was this
I,
in Australia.
In Australia, huh? Sorry, I'm from Melbourne. And so that whole concept of learning the language with my grandparents. So whenever I hear Italian, I can understand it quite well, and I feel like I can enter that world, and it's so nice and comforting, and it also takes me back to the memory of my grandparents. And then I went over when I was 5, so my parents took me over, so I had this connection, and I must have absorbed it a bit like the sponge factor, and then I think that created this idea that I really wanted to keep learning because I had this connection to Italy. And then I had to write all these notes because there was so much coming up. And then, for my grandmother, I would interpret for her. So I felt a power in knowing the language. That was, I could be useful and of service. What else? But then I learned it in high school because it was available. It wasn't available in primary school. My niece and nephew have Italian. They're also learning Greek. So I'm like, if they're learning
that's
Greek, because my brother-in-law's Greek, they've got to learn Italian. So it's at school. So that's really great. And then I learned art history. So that was also, so much of that is about the Italian history. And then I also did ballet, which is interesting because it's classical music, and then the French. It's learnt. You learn the French because all the positions and everything are in. So I think that's God. It's the opportunities that I had, the capacity, because I don't know. I'm not sure about the capacity side of it. And what was the other one? Desire. So my parents have really created that desire, and also I think through the teachers that I had, and they were very inspiring. And when I go over to Italy, they always say that my Italian is better than their English, so I have to speak Italian. So it's interesting that way. The practicality of it. And I think in Australia, particularly in Melbourne, with the Centre of Italian Studies, they'll always teach their Italian classes only in Italian. They won't speak English, so I think we have lots of benefits in Melbourne.
Yes, a lot of teachers should be aware that this instilling in how children reason about their how they imagine themselves as a future speaker of the language is really quite a subtle and small process that happens at a particular time. It happens differently for boys from girls. Boys have Boys are more less ego permeable at adolescence and really don't like speaking in a second language in front of their friends, And in schools where we just adjust the kind of activities that you do so that you don't create embarrassment for them, and then what they've learnt later, earlier they retain, and then when they get over this problem, they're more comfortable speakers. There's a lot of ways of structuring the staging and the pedagogy around understanding learners as semi-autonomous people who have desires and problems and psyches, and they're not empty vessels to be filled in with grammar. And if we were to understand language like this, but infusing it deeply with what we know diaspora challenges of language maintenance are, which are heavy. I mean, language loss is practically universal. And you just look at Argentina. Argentina is an extraordinary case. I think it was Anthony said the other day, 52%, was it you that said that, of the population of Italian, Italian ethnicity. The language is practically absent, although when people speak Spanish on the streets in Buenos Aires, there's heavy Italianization of ordinary speech. But the kind of strategy for the promotion of Italian in a situation like that would be really different from what the government actually does, the Italian government actually does. And I've looked at it and I thought, it takes no account of the sociolinguistic reality that surrounds them. And that's because they've formed their principles of what to do on the basis of two things, the Legge 153, which was the teaching of the migrant workers' children in Belgium or somewhere or other, and they won't modify, or to modify law in Italy takes forever, we know anyway, but they could modify the practice that they support and what they do. And secondly, they could at least base what their interventions are on a study of the situation in which this intervention is supposed to take place, rather than have this one-size-fits-all model, which is just more teaching in the classical way, and we'll tell you about, Florence in the 15th century or something.